Hello everyone, this is Matteo and today I'm starting a deep dive into ComfyUI and Stable Diffusion. This will be the first in a series of basic tutorials about Comfy, but also generative machine learning in general. We'll start from the very beginning, but we are going to touch rather advanced topics, so even if you know your way around ComfyUI, I bet there will be something for you as well. So let's get into it. This is the default basic workflow that we all know and love. Let's build it from scratch and analyze each element. A double click on the work area brings up the search dialog. 99% of the times I add nodes from there, but if you don't remember the name of a node, you can right click and look for the node in the menu. First of all, we need to load a main checkpoint. A checkpoint is a container format that packs three main components. The first is the Unet model, which is the brain of the image generation. The second is the clip or text encoder that will take care of converting the text prompt into a format the model can actually use. And the third is the variational autoencoder or VAE that brings the image to and from the latent space. It's an incredibly important element in the image generation and it's often overlooked. Let me show you what it does. I made this node called Tensor Shape Debug. It shows in the terminal the dimensional size of various objects used by ComfyUI. The shape of these objects, or tensors, gives us some insight on the information that they contain. Let me show you. I'll put the terminal window here so we can see the result. If I open an image and send it to the node, I get as a result 1, 768, 512, and 3. The first is the batch size, the second and third are height and width of the image, and the last one is the number of channels, red, green, blue. If I make a batch, you'll see that the first number becomes 2, as the tensor now contains 2 images. As you know, to do any kind of manipulation over this image, I'd need to bring it to the latent space. The latent is a smaller representation of the original pixel image that Stable Diffusion can actually use. Let me convert this image to a latent. I need a VAE encode. I connect the VAE pipeline and then check the shape with the debug node. Now I get 1, 4, 96 and 64. The dimensions are arranged differently, but what we care about is 96 and 64, that are 768 and 512 divided by 8. So our image has been downscaled 8 times per side and can now be used for the generation. This compression is handled by the VAE, that is generally very good at it, but not lossless. When we want to display the latent, we need to upscale it back to the pixel space. If I take this latent and decode it, the two images look the same at first sight, but if I pass them through an image enhanced difference node, you'll see that there are actually a lot of differences. Basically, anywhere that is not black, it means that something changed. So, since the VAE encoding slash decoding is a lossy, computational expensive process, it's advisable to stay as much as possible in the latent space and convert to the pixel only at the very end. Also remember that when creating an empty latent image, the width and height refer to the final image resolution, but the actual latent size is divided by 8. So it's always a good idea to work with images with dimensions that are multiple of 8. Next is the clip. We can drag the output, release the mouse button on the work area, and select Clip Text Encode. I like to change the color of the nodes so I can easily tell which is which, but that's just me. The text encode converts the prompt into embeddings so they can be used by the model to generate something meaningful. We will talk more about embeddings later. For now, let me just connect the prompts to the KSampler. If the checkpoint is the brain, the KSampler is the heart of the generation, and I could talk about this node alone for hours. but instead of going through all the options one by one, we'll learn by example during the course of these and future tutorials. Let me connect the model, and of course we need the latent. For a new generation, we are going to use an empty image. Models are trained at a specific resolution. For SD15, that's usually 512 by 512, so we'll start with that. Then I need to decode the image back to the pixel space, and finally I can display it with a preview. As prompt, I'm gonna try something like close-up illustration of an anthropomorphic panda wearing a full plate armor in an enchanted forest, and some generic negatives. Let's see what we get. Since I want to experiment with various options, I need consistent result, so I'm setting a fixed seed. I'm also increasing the batch size so we can get more results. So the result is good already, but as you can see, we have some food, which is something we didn't ask for. This is because the model doesn't consider full plate armor just one token, and if you say plate, it assumes that you are hungry. So let me remove it and see if it works. Now it's perfect. Let me also remove illustration, since Dream Shaper, the checkpoint that I'm using, has already a strong illustration character. Now it is a bit better. This is just to show you that you don't always need long, overly complicated prompts, but the right choice of words is much more important. Okay, now it's time to open that can of worms, that is, samplers and schedulers. The one thing that I'm asked the most is probably what is the best sampler. I'm sorry guys, but the answer is depends. It depends on the checkpoint, on the CFG scale, on the number of steps, on the complexity of the embeds, and ultimately on your own personal taste. Let me show you some examples to explain what I mean. I'm copying this KSampler, and with Shift-Ctrl-V I get a new node with all the pipe connections from the previous node. In the second KSampler I set DPM++ to mCaras, which is regarded as one of the best. I'm also setting the steps very low to like 10 to see which sampler is able to converge faster. The steps is the number of iterations the sampler has to denoise an image. Let's see the result. As you can see, Euler, even with only 10 steps, was able to denoise the pictures almost completely. Here between the eyes we still have some leftover noise, but a lot better than DPM++. Now I'm changing the CFG to 2. It means that the model now has a lot more freedom. It's an extreme value that you rarely use with standard checkpoints, but it's just for the sake of this experiment. Cue prompt. And now things changed completely. Euler images are very faded out and blurry, while DPM++ was able to generate some very nice results. Even increasing the number of steps to 20, DPM++ still has the upper edge. With this generation we used a very simple prompt, and with a more detailed description probably things would change again. So as I said, it depends. There are a few certainties that I can give you though. First of all, there are two kinds of sampler. I'm not aware of an exact name for the two groups, but let's divide them in predictable and stochastic. The former are converging and the latter not converging. Euler, DPM++, 2M, DDIM, UniPC produce predictable noise. All ancestrals, SDE, and a few others have more randomness, hence stochastic. If I set a converging sampler in the first generation and a not converging one like DPM++ to MSDE in the second, you'll notice that Euler keeps the overall composition no matter the number of steps. The second KSampler instead will keep making variation even after 100 steps. Why using an unstable sampler, you may ask? Well, sometimes you want to spice up the image generation a little, and often a stochastic sampler offers very interesting results. So at the end, you need to experiment. Each scenario is different, but if you don't know where to start, I'd suggest to try Euler, DPM++ to M, UniPC, DPM++ to MSDE, DDPM, and DPM Adaptive. Same goes for schedulers. Karas is generally good, but some samplers like DPM++ 2 and 3M SDE really like exponential or SGM uniform. There are also some scenarios where normal outperforms other schedulers, like when working with upscaled latents for some reason. And we'll talk about that soon. So to sum up our KSampler, steps is how many times the sampler can denoise the image. The CFG or guidance scale controls how much the image generation follows your directions. Lower values, the model decides. Higher values, you decide. Sampler and scheduler define the denoise strategy and timing. And denoise is another important parameter, but we'll talk about that later. Nice. With that out of the way, we can move on to conditioning. I'm removing the second KSampler and adding a tensor shape debug node so we can see how the embeddings are actually made. If I run the generation now and look at the terminal, I see that I have two tensors, but what I care about is the second value, 77. This is basically the maximum number of tokens per embedding that we can have. Even if we use less words, the size will be 77. If I have a very long prompt and check again, the size is now 154 or 77 times 2. And even if I only have 78 tokens, the tensor size will be 154. This is important because in a moment it will help us understand various conditioning strategies. So let's say I want to put a red scarf to our panda. I'm adding red scarf to the text prompt and see what happens. It got a red scarf alright, but the color also bled onto the armor. Here we've got a red gem, and overall the scene has now a reddish tint. Not to mention that for some reason this one panda got boobs. To try to fix that, we can use conditioning concat. I add a new text prompt and put the red scarf there and remove it from the previous prompt. Now I connect them together and I'm also checking the tensor shape with the debug node. Now we have a lot less red, the scene lost the red tint, and we also got some blue and brown details. Let's have a look at the tensor shape. It's now 154, despite the tokens are far less than 77. What happened is that Comfy concatenated the two full tensors one after the other. This technique makes the tokens in each tensor bleed far less than putting everything into one text prompt. There's now another node that I want to try, conditioning combine. Let me move everything to the new node and see what happens. Well, now we got something completely different. Let's see the tensor size to understand what is happening. We have now four tensors instead of two, and the size is for both 77. This means that the embeddings are not merged, but sent directly to the model instead. The model creates a starting noise for both embeddings, like there were two different pictures, and then average them before starting the generation. This also explains why we got some snow in one of the images, because without any other context, one of the generation associated the red scarf with winter. So let's give the second prompt more context. I'm basically replicating the first prompt, but with red scarf instead of full armor. And now the scene is more what we wanted. There's one more conditioning that I want to explore, conditioning average. Let's say I don't want a panda, but a dragon panda. I can try my luck with just one prompt, with close-up of an anthropomorphic dragon panda. Let's see. Well, it tried. We got some horns and some wings, but we can do better. Now I'm creating two identical prompts, one with dragon and one with panda. Connect them together with a conditioning average and set the strength to 0.5. I'm also going to check the debug. And now we got a proper dragon panda. Since it looks more dragon than panda, I'm going to change the strength a little. I want to give the panda more weight, so I'm setting the strength to 0.4. and now it's much better. If we check the terminal, we see that the tensor size is now still 77, even though we used two prompts. That's because both prompts are under 77 tokens and Comfy averaged them into one tensor. So to recap, conditioning concat takes the two embeddings, put them one after the other and send them together to the sampler. Conditioning combined sends the individual embeddings, creates the base noise for both, and then average the noise to start the generation. Conditioning average takes the two embeddings and average them before sending emerged tensor to the sampler. There's one more conditioning I want to talk about, and it's also probably the most powerful. Conditioning time step. I need one node for each prompt, and then I'm merging them together with conditioning combine. In the first prompt, I put illustration of a fantasy village in spring, and in the second, the same, but in winter. Let's check the result. So winter has a stronger weight, so I want to try to lower the strength of winter by setting the start option in the timestepping node to 0.2. This means that at the beginning, the model will ignore the winter prompt and proceed to create only a spring scene. At 20% of the composition, the sampler will start adding winter too. If I increase the start option, the scene will get greener and greener. And if I want to introduce some snow back, I can stop adding spring at like 70%. By setting the end option to 0.7 in the second prompt. This is a very useful tool and I would like to see it used more often. Remember that the initial steps are the most important, so you generally want to start the time stepping at 0 for the prompt that has to have the higher importance. One quick note about textual inversion and word weighting. It's very basic stuff, but I thought it was worth mentioning for the sake of completeness. Once you've downloaded the embeddings and placed them inside the ComfyUI models embeddings directory, you can access them with the embedding keyword. For example, I have an embedding called bed dream. Let's give it a try. And if I want to give it more or less weight, I select it and with control and up and down arrows, I can increase or decrease the weight. This is of course also true for any other word in the negative or the positive prompt. Just remember that embeddings are like words and their position inside the prompt matters. So an embedding at the beginning will have a higher value compared to one at the end. Great. There's one last thing that we need to cover in this tutorial. We talked about how a checkpoint is actually a container for Unet, Clip, and VAE. This also means that each of these components can be loaded separately with their own node. For the main model, you can use the Unet loader, for the text encoder, the Clip loader, and for the VAE, the VAE loader. The VAE loader is very important because the checkpoint not always comes with the best VAE, so you can load one externally. Check the model page on Civitai or Hugging Face, most of the times it says what VAE to use. The Unet and Clip loader can be useful when a checkpoint is not available. For example, on Hugging Face I've found this very curious model designed to make nail art. If I go in the Files and Version tab, I find very familiar directories called VAE, Unet, and Text Encoder. From here, I can download each model and place them in the ComfyUI, Unet, Clip, and VAE directory. You can also rename them for easy access. Now the models should show up in the respective node. I can delete the load checkpoint node and connect the clip and model pipelines to the new nodes. This model has a trigger which is nail set, so I start the prompt with that and then I add something like zombie apocalypse. Let's see what happens. Oh well, that's not too bad. Or let's try dragons. Well, by the way, now you know how to use models even if you can't find the checkpoint format. I guess that's all for this first introduction tutorial. It takes me a lot more time to do these videos that cover the basics compared to my standard content. So please let me know if you like it and if you want me to release more. My idea is to alternate advanced stuff and these basic tutorials, but we'll see depending on your reception. That's all for today. See you next time. Ciao.